Because we're live.
Oh, we're always live. But anyway, let me tell you, I am here in my hunkered down cave. I think I'm in my own Snyder Cut. Anyway, now this is a great show. You know, Jordan has worked so hard. He even put a flower in his hair for this exact moment of the day. It is the premiere of the Showies. Yes, it's been building for so long. The Showies, people have been saying, hey, Dutch, hey, Jordan, what do you guys want to do? Why don't you give your awards out for the best of non-recognized actors? You know, the Oscars can have their recognized, you know, mainstream. We're going with whoever we want to put in the thing. You know, Nicolas Cage?
Like the real Oscars. The winners won't be here to accept either.
yeah, absolutely. And could Nicolas Cage be nominated on my list? Could he be nominated on Jordan's list? Ooh, every now, year. No. Every year. Right now he is in the top lead actor category for next year's Showies. But, you know, because we're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to be talking great movies from Mortal Kombat to Willy World to you know, whatever we have out there, Synchrony. So it's going to be fun. So Jordan, without further ado, sir, tell the kids what they've won at home.
Yeah, first of all, I'm excited for the first ever, the 2021 Showies. I mean, I've been getting, people have been trying to bribe me all week long. You know what I mean? Sliding money into my pocket. I go, no, we have integrity. We will rule this with an iron fist, but we will be fair and we will give you a shot. So, you know, I'm looking forward to that very much. And like you say, we got some fun movie reviews. We're kicking it off. You want to do the first movie review? Who sent that up, baby?
Well, I'll take it from here, sir. I'll take the first one if you want me to, because that's what I'm here for. The first movie we're going to talk about is Mortal Kombat. A washed-up MMA fighter, Cole Young, unaware of his heritage and hunted by the Emperor Shang Tsung's best warrior, Sub-Zero, seeks out and trains with Earth's greatest champions as he prepares to stand against the enemies of the Outworld in a high-stakes battle for the universe. This has Louis Tan, Jessica McNam, I don't know, Josh Lawson, McCade Brooks, and Haruko Sanada? Hiroyuki? I like that one. Hiroyuki Sanada. There you go. See, whew, some of my New Japan's wearing I'm getting to me, huh? Well, John, what do you think about this film here? What did you think about it?
All right, man. This dropped on HBO Max. It actually took me a couple of days. I had a busy weekend, so I was a tiny bit late to the party. I was hearing it almost every day, though, you know, about this movie. I had a lot of fun with this, man. Met if not surpassed expectations here. The money's on the screen. It's fun seeing like Sub-Zero into the real world here. This was just fun, man. If you're looking for a deep story, you're not going to really find it here, but if you're looking for good fights here, some scene stealing stuff from Josh Lawson here as Kano, I had to look him up, man. This guy's a chameleon. This guy's been in Anchorman 2. He was in Superstore. He was a regular in Superstore. A regular guest star, and I had no idea, and he's just here, and you know, the bad parts, there is a little bit of, you know, the main guys, you're not as interested in him as you probably should be here, and you know what I mean, there's some characters that are there just simply to appear, look cool, and then die or move on from. Did you even catch the WWE alumni in the movie?
I did not, sir. Who was this WWE alumni?
Nathan Jones, baby. Nathan Jones had a role in the movie. He's a big hammer dude. And I believe let me enchanter my actor and give you a reciting of all of those lines.
Okay, go for it.
And there you go. So that was Nathan Jones in Mortal Kombat.
He's the next rock in the making, everybody. Yes, Nathan Jones.
On paper, he's had a good run. I mean, Troy, The Condemned, other things. I had fun with this, man. What would you think?
You know, I'm going to be honest. I know at first when we were first introduced to Cole, I was sitting there watching him, and I was like, okay, so he has a cool little sister hanging out with him in the locker room, And there's his girlfriend, right? Little did I know they were husband and wife, and that was his child. Okay, I didn't piece all that together until she said dad. Okay, so that was kind of a weird thing going on there for a second. I was kind of like, well, okay, well, I'll forgive him for that. But yeah, I love the backstory of where Sub-Zero and Scorpion first meet. And that I love the ancient times. You know, I love those times. Those type of films. I'll be talking about one next week that are a setback in those days, but it was like 1788 or something like that, and it was just unbelievably good. I love the fight scenes that took place there. All in all, though, I thought it was a fun, as you say, Kano is the reason to watch this film. He steals a lot of the scenes. Whatever they gave him, he took, devoured, and spit it out with fun, and he looked like he was enjoying the process. You had Blade, who was, what was her name, Jessica Blade, is her Blade?
Sonya Blade.
I apologize. I never was very good at the games, because I could never get my fatality to go. I was always a kick.
Fatalities. It's like
I was
these four buns at once. Come on.
Yeah, I was a kicker and a puncher. So it was like finish him. Hi-ya! And he just falls over. That's my way of doing the fatalities.
Might have the same skill of Mortal Kombat players.
We're just kicking and slapping. That's all we do. But all in all, though, I think who was the Reno is the shot guy, right? I just thought to me they underdeveloped his character and made him more of a god and just not. He was just there.
And Shang Tsung don't have a lot in this, and there's a couple of ones that have even less.
Yeah, and I kind of wish they would have tried to maybe build it up a little bit more, so we could have had something that where we cared a lot about the characters, which we don't as much. But again, I had fun with this. I think they could build upon this now. It's a success as it stands. I think it could be built upon, in which they could actually focus maybe on a story, and where you could really like the characters as they come. You have The Miz right now wanting to be Cage, Johnny Cage, which, you know what, why not? He's primed, he's ready to go. So I even the director thought that would be an interesting choice if you follow the tweets out there. So it's pretty interesting. I'm going to tell you what I gave it, and then I'm going to let you in that. I gave it 3. It's watchable. It's fun. It's not the greatest, but it is worth your time to invest.
I will bump up actually a little bit more than you, my friend. I'm going to give it a solid 3.5. I think it's definitely a recommendation for me. Maybe the kind of perfect movie. Big screen might have been fun here. I think we missed some of the fun of Kong and Godzilla because of that. This I had a lot of fun with here, man. Like you said, there's some parts that dialogue is a little bit eye-rolly, and a couple wooden deliveries of here and there from some of the side characters. But I think it's enough fun, I think it gets what you're looking for as far as a Mortal Kombat fan. So, recommendation for me and for you as well.
And way better than the original trilogy, I guess they came out with. I do
miss. Well, it's actually only 2. There is no trilogy. Oh,
well, I count the cartoon.
I do miss Christopher Lambert though, but that might just be me.
Well, I miss Highlander as well. So we'll be fine.
Coming up next, you find that, of course, on HBO Max. Coming up next, going over to Netflix here, it's Hillbilly Elegy. An urgent phone call pulls a Yale law student back to his Ohio hometown, where he reflects on 3 generations of family history and his own future. This stars Amy Adams, Glenn Close, the recent Oscar nominee, who evidently knows a lot about the butt, Gabriel Basso, Owen Astalos, Haley Bennett, and Freda Pinto. So this was an obvious kind of Oscar grabby type film. It did grab Glenn some love. Adams is also really good here. And this is a very divisive movie as well. Some people, I think, have really called it out on how it's really trying to be kind of Oscar grabby and like kind of exploiting kind of this culture. I kind of went with it more than not. I'm sold on the performances here. It grabbed my heartstrings at certain points. Again, if I feel like if this wasn't with these two A-listers, Adams and Close, it probably wouldn't have been as good here. But I kind of went with it, man. It's Ron Howard, who's had kind of a mixed bag himself these last few years. Yeah. But I was also pulled in by the two young actors that played the son in this, Owen, and then what did I have it right here? Oh, Gabriel Basso, that were pretty good in this as well. So it's an interesting story. It's based on a true story here. Sometimes it's really making this kid look great. But yeah, I thought it was pretty good. I give it 3 stars. You know, obviously, you know, Close got nominated here, so there's enough in this that I think is worth checking out. But you know, I can understand why I didn't rush to and why other people have given it even less.
Yeah, I did not see it. I'm one of those people who just probably won't watch it. We'll chime in more about the Oscars later, and I'll tell you what we'll talk about that. The next film we're going to talk about is Synchronic. They're off of Netflix, I believe. Two New Orleans paramedics' lives are ripped apart after encountering a series of horrific deaths linked to a designer drug with a bizarre otherworldly effect. This has Anthony Mackie, who just seems to be on our tear lately, Jamie Dorn, and Kate Aslington. Now, tell me, Jordan, I didn't watch this. I know it's out there to watch. What was your come away from it?
Yeah, this one's a hard one for me to review as well, because I really feel like it was going somewhere. I liked everyone in it. You know, Dorn in for his 50 Shades past. He is starting to become a really interesting actor to watch here, and Mackie's really good. He is definitely the lead in this. It starts off kind of as a two-hander, but then it goes more into Mackie and him exploring with this crazy drug that kind of literally transports him to different places here. And so some of the set scenes are really good, and it's kind of nice looking. Obviously, they're working with the budget, but they work with it as well as they can. It's one of those movies that I feel like, did it really mean too much, though? Like, it's just, did the ends really qualify? And I don't know. I'm very torn on it, because I almost feel like this could have been given maybe like a miniseries, or there's an idea here, but I don't think it's ever fully realized. You know what I mean? Like, all these quick scenes you're seeing, there's not really a hell of a lot more to it. You know what I mean? It's a very more visual than I think actual like delivering type movie here. So I think it's worth checking out, but I have a hard time giving like a fuller recommendation, because I never really felt fulfilled in really knowing these characters, where they were going. The ending's okay, but even then I kind of have problems with. I thought about giving it a 3. I kind of only have to give it 2.5. I'm right smack dab in the middle of, like, there's enough to where I enjoyed it, but not enough to give it a full hardcore, you know, recommendation.
Just watching the clips that you just showed, to me, it seems as if it was more of a two-man Jacob's ladder, but more aware of what's going on. To a point, you know what I'm saying? Because Jacob's Ladder, you know, he's just lurking on his hallucinogens, you know, that are just kicking in later. This looks like just one hallucination right after another, but, you know, through these pills. But, you know, that's what I grabbed from it, like a poor man's Jacob's Ladder, because I know how you love that movie with Tim Robbins.
I do. Jacob's Ladder has a direct story, though. This side just felt like lacked in the story element. It's there in the background, but then I think it just gets lost in them kind of going, oh, this scene will look cool, and then this scene will look cool, but it didn't justify the means.
Okay, gotcha. So what's next up on our list here, bud?
Oh boy, oh boy. it's the stand-in. When ordered to serve a year in rehab, actress Candy hires her on-set stand-in to take her place. The unassuming woman flips the script and steals her identity, career, and boyfriend in this comedy about trading places. This stars Drew Barrymore, TJ Miller, Michael Ziegen, Ellie Kemper, and Holland Taylor. Now, when I was grabbing the info for this, you know, the plot, the stars, the plot lied to you, and I edited it because I don't want to lie to our fans. It said in this hilarious comedy about trading places. I had it hilarious, because that would be lying. This movie sucks.
Did you watch the previews? I'm just wondering, did you watch them?
I think I saw the trailer once, and then it's another one like Synchronic. It wasn't an original Netflix movie, but it's on Netflix now.
It is? I didn't even know.
It was 1 or 2 a.m. I threw it on. I loved Drew Barrymore. I was excited to see her in a lead. We haven't seen her in a lead in a while. I think what was the last movie she was a lead in? Was it the one where Toni Collette's dying? I don't even remember. but this thing's it's not funny. And it's such a weird setup, too, because, okay, at first you're like, oh, okay, the stand-in's the nice one, the one we get to love and care about. And then the other version is really shitty and a drunk and mean to everyone, TJ Miller, everyone around her, she's rude, too. But then the stand-in ends up being an even bigger piece of shit in a different way, and she's not fun to watch. And the comedy fails, and the background for the boyfriend is weird and not funny, and it just, oh, man, weird twist side of,
yeah this is a movie that I saw in the previews and I was like, that is one to stay away from. It's kind of like the Real Drew Barrymore Show, if you ever have a chance to ever glance at that on daytime television.
I've seen clips.
That is a trash television show, literally. I mean, she can't even hold your attention. You want to just slit your wrist in the middle of watching that show. It is a bad show. And I think the only reason why they keep it on is they're hoping that it turns into an Ellen, but there's only one Ellen, and this is Drew Barrymore, who can't carry anything to save her life right now, because this right here would make you not want to ever watch a movie with her in it. So it's a shame. It's a shame to see somebody with so much talent just basically start just phoning it in, I guess, at this point.
So. Also, very, very distracting makeup from her, too, when she's the stand-in. They could have just gone with what is it, a Parent Trap? Like, oh, we looked alike, but no, they're like, let's add on really shitty, obvious makeup just to make things even worse. Yeah.
Well, hey, so what did you say you gave this? Did you even give me a number?
I haven't given you a number yet. I even forgot to play the trailer. I was so distraught thinking about this movie. I could be nice and say 1.5, but I'd be lying. I'm going to give it a 1.
Speaking of careers on the upside, going down or going up, I'm not sure how you want to say it, but I enjoyed this next film, and I'm ruining my own preference, but it's called Willy's Wonderland. When his car breaks down, a quiet loner agrees to clean an abandoned family fun center in exchange for repairs. He soon finds himself waging war against possessed animatronic mascots while trapped inside Willy's Wonderland. This has Nicolas Cage, Emma Tosta, and Beth Grant. I want to talk about it first. Can I do that? And then I want to hear what you say, because I really, really want to hear what you say. I knew what I was going in for. I didn't realize it was going to be kind of, this could be one of those that gin up to have a great cult following, I think. Because, not one time does Nicolas Cage utter other than a grunt, I believe, in this film, or a holler. But he doesn't speak. I thought it was a great pantomime by this Oscar Academy Award-winning actor here. I just thought it was a fun, different type film. We find out, the ones, it's like going to a murderous Chuck E. Cheese, if you really want to put it anywhere close to anything. It's like all the characters that were in Chuck E. Cheese have been possessed by these serial killers. And so basically the town makes a pact to feed these psychopaths so they don't feed on their own town. And I found it just a fascinating watch. I loved most of the scenes. The only scene that I found was kind of odd is the couple and having sex. There's always that time where people have sex in a horror film. You know what I'm talking about? It's the most odd place to do it when they know they're all going to die. If they're all going to die, all of a sudden they take their time. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, guys, get the hell out. If you think you got to get out, get out. Okay. But Nicolas Cage was there to do a job because he wants his car, in this corrupt town. It's just a fun thing. And by the way, I watched the credits and I think it was all filmed in Korea, because there was not one. It was all a Korean production cast. It was all like Korean or Chinese or something. It was I think they filmed this overseas somewhere, but they did get a Georgia credit for sound, if that helps you. So what were your thoughts on this wondrous of Wonderlands? Tell me, my friend.
I wanted to follow you on that journey that you just spoke about. And I did for the first solid 30, 40 minutes. I was like, cool. Nicolas Cage, he's barely speaking. He doesn't speak in the end. You find out. He's animatronics. He's fighting them. And then it went on repeat for far too long. I did not care about the last 30, 40 minutes. He doesn't really have that much of a hard time. The kids are dumb. You mentioned the sex thing. How about the other scene where all the kids know, these kids that get trapped in with them, they all know that, oh, these things murder. And then they're just staring at him at first, like, oh, what is going to happen? And the kid gets stabbed. And it's like, okay, yeah. Well, and then the other two go off and have sex. And then it just repeats and other bad decisions are made. And then I just felt like this thing got way too much on a pause and just didn't know what else to do. It had a good premise and a good 45 minutes. And I'm going right smack dab in the middle of it too. 2.5. Like, it's enough to where it bid the time, but I just couldn't get any more than that though.
I'm going to give this a positive little bumper for you though. I gave it 3. I think you should watch it. I think it will be a cult movie one day. Mark my words, it may take about 10 years or so to make it cult status.
I mean, it's making noise now, so.
But I thought to me, I want a Willy Wonderland t-shirt, by the way. I really do. And
Willy shirt, which I liked.
Yeah, I loved it. And I loved how he was on he was basically, when it's time for a break, he took his break. I love that. You know, that's commitment, my friends. You know, and he loved his orange, his grape soda, I believe it was. So, yeah, I just thought it was a great little fun romp. It wasn't the greatest. You're right. It does hit a spin recycle button, throughout the film. But I just found it, I don't know. I just love Nicolas Cage.
There's also a really big editing problem that I had, too, that I want to talk to you about later.
Oh, you know what? There is one, and the scar. Is that what you're talking about?
There's two.
Yeah, because the cut on his face, that happens, and yeah, I noticed a couple of things like that. We could go into that later, because I still could forgive it. I just thought it was just a decent premise, and I think people should enjoy it. So, just give it a shot. Wait till it comes down in price, and then go get it. Willy's
like me, rented on Netflix DVD.
Well, mine was free because of my Google surveys money. So,
Alrighty, last here on the movie docket for this week, the Kid Detective, a once celebrated kid detective now 31, continues to solve the same trivial mysteries between hangovers and bouts of self pity until a naive client brings him his first adult case to find out who brutally murdered her boyfriend. This stars Adam Brody, Sophie Nalise, Sarah Sutherland, Zai Ma, Peter McNeil, Randy Carson, and Jonathan Whitaker. So I haven't seen this one yet, but you did, so talk us up.
Let me tell you, I enjoyed this. It doesn't get a lot of play. I've been looking for it for a long time. Then it finally hit the 99-cent rental button, and I was like, I have to get it. And it's basically Adam Brody plays a kid detective who basically is the shining star of his town until one day a girl goes missing, and he can't solve the mystery, so everyone treats him like crap after that. As he gets older, his parents aren't supportive. He still wants to be a detective. And like you say, this the girl's boyfriend does get murdered. She comes to him, and he thinks this is a real chance to prove that he can be that detective that people thought he could be. And it's really it's a slow burn on some in most directions. But by the way, I'm just going to say this: Ma out there, Zai Ma. He had a heck of a 2020, if you ask me. Tiger Tail, this one, and he was a Mulan. So good props for him this year. And I just thought, the way Adam Brody portrayed this character was just unbelievably good. He's a down on his luck, doesn't believe in himself, has parents that berate him, people who just he called him insufferable, and as he moves through it, just puts on a good performance all the way through. And I was shocked about how I always liked Adam Brody. You've always liked Adam Brody, I believe. And, you know, and I thought to me, this is well worth the watch. I gave this one 4. It's well worth the watch. Like I said, it's just, it's a movie that I cannot believe I waited this long to watch, but the price point was perfect for me. And it will be on Stars if you subscribe to that shortly. But if you don't subscribe to Stars, it's cheaper just to get the 99-cent rental at this moment. So, but yeah, 4 stars. That's what I
get. Well, if 99 cents last free, it means I'll have a review next week.
Okay. Well, I will hold you to that, sir. Okay. The next place we're going to go is our television shows. This week, we barely have any because we have such a great action-packed showies. That's why I kind of narrowed it down just to watching 2, and they're going to be quick. So the first one is the second season of Tiny World over there on Apple Plus. It is a awesome series. If you get a chance to watch it, as you can see, they show the mighty mites of the world, and they get down and this is, I think, season 1 right here that you're seeing, you know, which is fine. But I love how they take their time with the cameras, and they don't set up anything. They just sit there and wait and wait and wait for things to happen. And, you know, and it's just a lovely, like they have a pond one, you know, that I saw this week, and a few others. And it's just it's a series that's, again, narrated by Paul Rudd, and it's well worth the watch. If you love nature and you have a good 4K television, this is what you want to watch. It's just a lovely, documentary show. The next one, I took it on your deal on this one. I may have talked about it in the past. I don't believe I ever did, but you talked about it. Lois and Superman, or Superman and Lois, right? Superman and Lois. And that's over there on the CW. Finally got around to taking a couple episodes in, which I've watched probably about half the season, I believe, now. And I find it fascinating. I love this take, and it's a refreshing take on family life with Superman. The kids, you know, sometimes are insufferable, like most children are, and so you're kind of like, oh, God, I can't believe they're acting this way. But I understand there's a lot of pressure that goes along with knowing that your father's Superman, but you don't want to share him because you want your father to be there too. And sometimes he's not there, and you can see it in Clark's eyes as he's Superman. He's missing the family life, and he wants just to be in the family world and put the superheroing on hiatus. And Lois is always due diligent looking for that scoop. But I found it a very, so far it's a very touching show. I mean, I enjoy it. They've rehashed a few things from the Smallville shows, but I'm okay with this. And I'm hoping for a second season so far, because I'm enjoying this season immensely. How have you been watching it as well?
Well, yeah, you said I was the first one to review it. No, yeah, I enjoyed it. I'm a couple behind right now, but no, I did too. I thought it was a refreshing take. I wasn't even necessarily planning on kind of delving into the show. I watched the first one because it was just the newest on my DVR. I was like, oh, let's give it a shot. But yeah, I enjoyed, man. I thought it was an interesting take, and yeah, I'm in it so far.
Okay, perfect. So, sir, without further ado, it is your segment. Take it over for me, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the first ever a show about show, the Showies. It's the first ever show. We've had Oscars, we've had Golden Globes, Blockbuster Awards, Awards. I don't know. The Kids' Choice Awards, the MTV. We need one more award show. So we have decided to nominate our own Best Supporting Actor, Actress, and then Actor, Actress, and then Best Film. 5 of them in each category here. And we decided no one that was nominated for an Oscar gets any love here. So,
yeah, no love for you if you got Oscar nommed.
Share love with these other people here. So we, as always, like with our top tens, I don't know what he's picking. He doesn't know what I'm picking. We're going to find out organically here. So let's start it off. Ladies and gentlemen, here are the nominees for Best Supporting Actress. Who's going first?
Well, you go first, sir. You want to go first? I'm going to let you go first.
And it's your show. And the nominees are Alison Brie, Promising Young Woman, Mary Holland, Happiest Season, Deborah Winger, Gajillionaire, Ellen Burstyn, Pieces of a Woman, and Hilary Swank for The Hunt.
Okay.
The winner is.
Do you want to do the winner after mine, or?
No, we'll go
one. Oh, okay. No, okay. Okay. I'm so excited. No, who knew who was going to win?
Emma Stone, La La Land. Oh, wait, hold on.
Wrong envelope.
Ellen Burstyn in Pieces of a Woman. Obviously, Vanessa Kirby got a lot of the love here, but I always said I also got a big shout out to Ellen Burstyn and Shia LaBeouf as well for really holding their own in here. Heartbreaking tale, hard tale to watch. Don't watch if you're looking for something uplifting here, but if you're looking for just a great heart-wrenching tale with some great actors here. Ellen Burstyn, previously nominated in an Oscar-wise for Wreck Room for Dreams, shows that she still fucking has it, man. 20 years later, she still has the goods here. And she's got her own stance. She differences her opinions from her daughter here, but and she even gives a decent proposal, but a proposal to Shia LaBeouf at one point about something he can do. And he's really good in here, and I just want to show some love to Ellen Burstyn.
Okay. Best Supporting Actress on my line is, the nominees are Sierra McCormick, The Vast of Night, Sophia Wills, Uncle Frank, Vanessa Hudgens, Bad Boys for Life. Yeah, there's always a weird one. Sarah Bolger, End of Sentence, and Sophia Lowe, Blow the Man Down. And the award goes to, hold on, this damn, I hate adhesives, I really do. The award goes to Sierra McCormick, The Vast of Night. Yes. Good job, young lady. Good job. Okay. The next up on the screen is Best Supporting Actor. I'll go first on this one.
Yeah, I was going to say, you're not going to say any more about Sierra McCormick. You're done?
No. She did a great job. She is. She was a wonder mite in this film. You know, she might have gotten the best actress, but, you know, I had to. She's one of the only three ladies in the show, and she's the one who might have been the lead. I don't. I'm bad with these things, but I thought she deserves the Best Supporting Actress in Vast of Night. But yeah, I enjoyed her. If you haven't seen her, I'm waiting for more from her. So that's always a good one. So there you go. I apologize. I didn't expand upon her. I make for bad radio. Anyway, the next category is for Best Supporting Actor. So I'll go first on this one. The Best Supporting Actors are Bill Murray for On the Rocks, Jermaine Clement, I believe. Jermaine Clement, I Used to Go Here. Hugh Grant, The Gentleman. Jonathan Majors, The Five Bloods. And Brian Dennehy in Driveways. This was a stacked. This was a hard one for me. But the winner is Hugh Grant, The Gentleman. Yes, Hugh. Good job, buddy. You know, I thought this was probably Hugh Grant's big breakout as a supporting actor this year. You know, he couldn't, you know, he's not going to ever stack up in that Paddington 2 category like he did a few years back. But this one, I have to tell you, Hugh Grant still has it as an actor, and he showed it completely against the likes of Matthew McConaughey and everyone else in that lovely Guy Ritchie show. So there's the winner, Hugh Grant, in my Best Supporting Actor, The Gentleman.
Very, very nice there. Some good nominees there. All right, so mine, Best Supporting Actor, the nominees are Clark Peters, The Five Bloods, Delroy Lindo, The Five Bloods, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, Trial Chicago 7, J.K. Simmons, Palm Springs, and Hugh Grant for The Gentleman. And the award goes to Delroy Lindo, Defy Bloods, the biggest snub of the Oscars, in my opinion here. You could say actor. I won't support him because I feel like it's such a big supporting cast. He's not necessarily in it any more than anyone else. So I went with supporting here personally here. Yeah, I mean, Delroy Lindo, he's always been an actor I've enjoyed. He's even been someone I'm like, oh, where's he been? I haven't seen him in a little bit here. Didn't know he was capable of this to a degree here, and very divisive character of, you know, he's not necessarily always doing the best thing for his son or anything like that here, but he's mesmerizing to watch. It's a Larry performance, and yeah, I gotta show some love to him.
Okay. So that I can't disagree with you. So the next category, please. What's the next category?
We shall now go for Best Actress of the Year, according to the showies, these two schmucks. All right, and the nominees are Kristen Milioti for Palm Springs, Elle Fanning for All the Bright Places, Elizabeth Moss for Invisible Man, Evan Rachel Wood for Cajillionaire, and Katherine Langford for Spontaneous. All right, and the winner is, as I try to pull up, okay. It's a movie I've been thinking about ever since I saw the trailer. It's The Invisible Man. It's okay. It's Elizabeth Moss. I mean, she's just one of, I think, of our finest actresses going today. Handmaiden Tale. Everything she's in, even little things like Get Him to the Greek. She can be lovely. She can be layered. She can be just a tour de force. This was a different take on a tale we've seen before here, and she's the one that sells it. You see the fear in the eyes. You see her trying to get through. Even the scene here that opens the trailer of her getting out is, you know, you're quiet yourself. I love a movie when they want you to be quiet and you're quiet in the theater because you're like, I don't want to wake him up either. I'm holding my breath.
And you're hoping that dog doesn't say a word either.
And that's why I'm a cat guy, because sorry Poochie, you make too much noise. Same thing with Loving Monsters. I was like, just leave the dog behind, he ain't worth it. So yeah, Elizabeth Moss here gets my pick.
Okay, the Best Actress nominees on the Duchess role goes to are Kristen Milioti, Palm Springs, Katherine Langford, Spontaneous, Anna Taylor-Joy, Emma, Issa Rae, The Photograph, and Cindy Flanagan, Never Really, Sometimes Never. And the award,
really, sometimes always.
Never Really, Sometimes Always. Yes, I apologize. Never Really, Sometimes Always. Okay, my bad. I apologize. I wrote it down. I was like 1 o'clock in the morning writing things down sometimes. The award goes to Sydney Flanagan. Never Really, Sometimes Always. God, she deserves that win. It was a great nominee group, I'll be honest with you, but she just put in such an emotional powerhouse of a young lady going through a decision of getting a I hope, like I said about Sierra McCormick, I want to see more of in the future. And, we're probably not going to be denied that. So there you go. Cindy Flanagan for Never Really, Sometimes and Always. Okay. The next nominee on the board is for Best Actor. Well, without further ado, here they are. Show the film clips. No, I'm just playing. We don't have any for me.
I'm not that quick. I did for you. Okay. That's all I have.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, I know. Okay. So, the first one is Zai Ma for Tiger Tail. Adam Brody for Kid Detective. Delroy Lindo, De Five Bloods. Andy Sandberg, Palm Springs. Ben Affleck, The Way Back. So, the award goes to Delroy Lindo for The Five Bloods. You know, you said it perfectly well earlier. This man put in a performance like no other. Yes, it's hard to differentiate who could be the lead, but I felt that he deserved the leading nom in this one. And, you know, to be able to play the range that he has in that character, you like him at moments, but then you really hate him at moments. And it's just a, like I said, he is just a great actor who I wish got more love and more roles. And like I said as well, this is almost a flawless movie. First time I could ever say that about any, you know, Spike Lee film. So I enjoy this a lot. And congratulations, Delroy Lindo, for winning Best Actor in my showies for The Five Bloods.
Very nice. Very nice. Yes, there's lots of love for him here. Coming up next now, Best Actor, according to JPO. All right, and the nominees are Ben Affleck for The Way Back, Andy Samberg for Palm Springs, Justice Smith for All the Bright Places, Shia LaBeouf for Pieces of a Woman, and Vince Vaughn for Freaky.
He almost made mine.
good love for Vince Vaughn, you know, showing his thing. But the winner is... Is there any doubt? It's Ben Affleck, everybody. It's Ben Affleck winning for The Way Back. And this is a movie that has still stuck with me to this day here. It is a movie where it's not necessarily about the sport. You know what I mean? It's about the man. It's about the man and his struggle and why there is a struggle here, man. That's something I think we forget about here, that you know, we use these struggles to try to cope with, you know, other things that have gone wrong in our lives here. And like a sports game, you're rooting for him not to make the basketball shot. You're rooting for him not to pick up a drink. You know what I mean? And you feel for him. And he's so damn good in this. This was a movie that was something that, you know, was in his heart. And you could just tell it in every scene here where you feel for the man. That's why he's a double nominee today. And for me, a winner. Mr. Ben Affleck, add me on Xbox Live at Ben Affleck.
Congratulations, Ben. I did enough for you to win in that category over there on Jordan's choices. So, the final award, I want you to go first, sir, because this is your showies. This is because I think you deserve the honor to give the first Best Film Award on your end first. Or do you want to end it? It's entirely up to you. You're the producer, but it's your show.
I'll go, man, and we'll end with you. You can be the main event. Let's go with Best Picture. The nominees are The Five Bloods, Invisible Man. Wait, Five Bloods is nominated, wasn't it?
No. Was it? No, I don't think it was. No, it was not. It was not. It was completely and utterly thrown out.
I'm just making sure I didn't screw up our own.
Because I'm going to be honest, I have it on my list as well. So
we screwed up together.
All yes.
Right. Nominees are The Five Bloods, King of Staten Island, Palm Springs, Invisible Man, and The Way Back. And the winner is for Best Picture. It's not La La Land. It's not Moonlight this year. It's The Way Back. I feel like I'm the real Oscars now. I feel like I'm ending on a whimper because I'm double talking now my own movie here. But I don't know, man. Like I said, I love this thing. You know, really stood out. It's something I was championing for because it was early in the year. And I feel like that happens a lot. You know, I feel like if you don't get released in the fall, you're kind of forgotten about, which I think to a degree is what happened with The Five Bloods, is that I feel like it just... What was it, just not on people's minds? Can they not go back in time? So, yeah, like I said, I just thought this was a really well-told movie, from the director to the writing to all the stars here, even comedian Al Madrigal, his part. The girl, I almost nominated the girl that plays his ex-wife. She's got a couple of really good scenes. Maybe this wasn't quite enough, so I gave it to the other actresses. So, yeah, Way Back is mine, and let's hear what you got. I'm looking forward to it.
Okay, I just want to double check on something to make sure even if we did screw up, I don't think we did. I just want to make sure nominations. I just want to pull that up real quick, but I don't don't think we did mess this up. So this is always a good sign.
Man, father of Jews.
No, we nope. We're 100%, 100% good. See, we're flawless, sir. So my nominees on the Duchess Showies nominees, our best film is one, The Five Bloods, Emma, Palm Springs, The Vast of Night, Never Really, Sometimes, Always. Whew. This is a tough group. The winner, The Vast of Night. That it is a shocker. It is a it was a toss up, but this one I really enjoyed thoroughly. I believe it doesn't get enough love. And of course, sci-fi never gets enough love. But I really do love this film. And the second, I could give you my runner-up, but it's not going to console anybody. So, but The Vast of Night is the movie to watch. So on my end. So there you go. Do we need to recap anything on this?
I mean, if you want, we can do a quick recap here. That was the 2021 Showies for Best Supporting Actress. I gave it to Ellen Burstyn of Pieces of a Woman. Best Supporting Actor, Delroy Lindo, The Five Bloods. Actress, Elizabeth Moss, Invisible Man. Actor, Ben Affleck, The Way Back. And The Way Back also won Best Picture.
Well, my Best Supporting Actress wound up with Sierra McCormick, The Vast of Night. Best Supporting Actor, Hugh Grant in The Gentlemen. The Best Actress went to Sidney Flanagan for Never Really, Sometimes, Always. Best Actor, Delroy Lindo for The Five Bloods. And for the best film of 2021, that would be The Vast of Night on my end. So there you go. I'm excited. I thought this did well. I when I really had to put it down, I was wanting to just mess it up and put that Nicolas Cage in Jiu-Jitsu, but I didn't. So I took your word and I said to myself, you know what? The man wants me to be serious. I was serious this time. And I had so much fun doing it. It was so hard though. It really was for the best picture because I love all these. They're like my children. But, you know, only one could actually
become the doctor. Your child, though, let's be honest.
One has to be the doctor, and one has to be the guy who sleeps on the couch. So.
Yeah, the artist who's struggling, yeah.
Yeah, so there you go. You know, who did you have for your second runner-up? I just want to know, now that the showies are all over, and, you know, we're just hanging out, talking, who is your runner-up for the best picture?
Ooh, that's a tough one. I would probably go between Five Bloods and Invisible Man. I'd probably go Five Bloods.
Yeah, the Five Bloods wound up my second. It was that close. I mean, and then I had to think about what made me, you know, kind of like bite my nails. You know what I'm saying? And if Vast Night wouldn't have come out, guarantee you the Five Bloods would have won. But, you know, hell, you know, Delroy Lindo cleaned up as a best supporting actor and best actor, so he can't complain. I'm very happy for him.
I thought that might happen here because I know a lot of people are saying him, but yeah, I don't know. I went with supporting for me.
Well, no, I'm not going to question you on that. I can see how you did it. They did it with Lakeith, and they did it with what's his name? I can never say his name. Daniel Kaluuya. So
you could argue that's Lakeith's movie. I mean, he is the main focal point to a degree. Well, even yeah, it's hard to say. They're kind of a two-hander.
Yeah, but I was probably went with Lakeith as the best actor. That's just me. He was robbed. Anyway, robbed twice, it seems. So thank you again, Jordan, for bringing in the showies. We'll try to make that a yearly. I'll show up after next year. I might show up next year because, I don't know, 100 episodes, right? I'm retiring. I think that's how that works. But anyway, I'm just keep doing this. We just keep saying it. We keep putting it out there.
Tonight's 83. Tonight's 83. You're almost there, buddy.
Yes, man, I gotta tell you, I could just stop the show, I'll be honest, but you know what though, I can't, because that would deprive the audience of just hearing from you and me chiming in or maybe repeating news that you already said, because it's that time, ladies and gentlemen, for news. Okay. And the notable stuff. Yeah. Stuff.
My favorite news is always when I say something and then 2 minutes later you repeat it because you weren't listening when I said it. So let's see how many times it happens tonight. Take a shot if it does. So we went over it a little bit before. The Oscars are in the can. Some of the important winners of the Oscars was Best Actor Anthony Hopkins for The Father. Supporting Actor went to Daniel Kaluuya for Judas and the Black Messiah. Actress Frances McDormand for Nomadland. Supporting Actress Yoo Seung-hyun for Minari. Animated Movie was Soul. Director Chloe Zhao for Nomadland. Writing for Adapted was The Father. Original Screenplay and Writing was Promising Young Woman. And Best Picture was Nomadland. Hey, you know, for a movie that we both, I think, give, what would you give it, a 3 stars? And I think I said 3.5 for Nomadland. It cleaned up pretty well. What's your feelings on the Oscars?
Nomadland was like one of the worst films that I rated. I think it was like 1.5 maybe.
No.
Like it was not in a 2-star effort. It was awful. I still say it was. I don't care what anyone thinks. I'm going to just be honest with you about these Academy Awards this year. I looked at them all, right? I watched one. I watched maybe no, I watched two. I didn't give you the Messiah one. But the point is, I've watched two, and it was the most depressing year for film. And I know it wasn't the greatest year for film, but they could have looked outside the box a little bit more. And instead of pushing us with this Nomadland, yes, it was beautiful. People were like, oh my God, can you believe cinematography got taken by a Mank? Yes, I can. Even though, you know, it was a beautiful... Yeah, I do buy that. I'm not going to, you know, secondhand string you. I'm just saying I don't. This year, yeah, the ratings were down as well. It had like 10.7 million or 10 point something million watching it this year. It went down because it wasn't as good as it could have been. You know, you were missing, I don't think you needed the big crowd. I like the way they have it, the intimacy that they had it this year. It was kind of pretty nice, you know, the setup. A lot of people hated the way it was set up. But, you know, I just find that this year's Oscars weren't that great. The movies were okay. They weren't like stand out. I need to go in, you know, there was no big buzz. You know, they said, well, it'll never top the 1998 Academy Awards where Titanic was. But I'm like, well, you know what? At least Titanic was watchable. You know what I'm saying? But oh, you never saw that one? But yeah, Kate Winslet and Leo, good job. But
Kate Winslet thing.
Yeah. So she won't let him on the door. That year, you know, 1998 was a great year for movies if you really want to look at it. But this year, yeah, it was a plague-ridden year. But, you know, I think it was just Hollywood could have given us something better, but they only gave us the most depressing films they could probably put out. And that's what they do. And I think and that's my opinion. I know I'm not into the thing, but not one of these movies made me say, you know what, I feel like, enjoying my life. You know, no. If most of these films, you want to slice your wrist at the end of the night.
Oscars is always serious. You don't get nominated for Palm Springs. You get nominated for Nomadland.
But that's what I'm saying, you know, I think, you know, you can take a little bit, take a little cue from your other brethren and, you know, stop being such, we only do it because it's the finest works. Yeah, we have fine works that we can watch, but we can also, and I think that's where the disconnect is now with Hollywood, whereas you had Regina King being snubbed, One Night in Miami, which was a decent film, being snubbed. You know, I just find, you know, there's ways to bring in views for audience members and for us to connect with the Hollywood regime again. And I don't think we see that anymore with the nominees lately. I just don't.
That's not fair. You just contradicted yourself. You said nominees, but the names you just mentioned for being snubbed were nominated.
Well, not Regina King. She was not. She was not nominated at all.
She did not.
So I just find it fascinating, you know, that these films, you know, like there's other films out there like Palm Springs. You know what? This was the year to just say, you know, it was a weird year. Let's have a weird, you know, a weird look at the way movies are instead of always trying to put through a message. I think nowadays, you know, a lot of movies have a lot of heavy-handed messaging, you know, and those are the ones that are always going to be dealt the, you know, nomination. I think, you know, the Five Bloods, I think Spike Lee was robbed, on that one. You know, the first time I'll ever defend Spike Lee, you know, for you know, cause, you know, the way he acts at Knicks games, don't really care for it. But yeah, but at the end of the day, though, I found this year's Academy class not that great, not that great at all. But I congratulate the winners. I'm not going to begrudge them. I thought that the Harrison Ford monologue was just unbelievably funny. I just love his grumpiness, surliness that when he goes out there. Here's a note. Why are they looking at the eggs three times? You know? And why are, you know, that was from Blade Runner. Okay, who you know, so it's just great. You know, he goes out there acting like the old curmudgeon, but I just love him. You know, and then of course, you know, we had that controversial ending, how people were or tried to make it a controversy, wherever the, you know, the guy, you know, Chaz Boseman, everyone wanted to see win, didn't win, because it's not a sure thing in Hollywood, who wins and who loses. It ended on a thud. You know, and as we talked before the show, it ended on a thud, and it was all because of production. You know, it could have ended on, as you said, Francis. You know, Francis.
Yeah, and how you always end, you can't predict. It's them trying to predict, and it screwed them in the pooch. So yeah, whoever produced that, unfortunately, you made the wrong decision. You know what I mean? Because you took something for granted that you can't take for granted. You know what I mean? Yeah. If you ask people that were polling the Oscars, I watch a show every once in a while called For Your Consideration. They would do a weekly show about where people stood in the Oscars. That shows you just how much things change. And Anthony Hopkins was not a crazy possibility. You know what I mean? It was a real possibility. He would win, and he did. And so, yeah, it's the Oscars' fault for doing that. Just take the best picture. You know what I mean? Like, because then it was such an odd ending of Joaquin going, "Well, he's not here. We accept on his behalf." And then they're like, bye.
it was 4 o'clock in Wales when he, you know, whenever this thing was being read. So he was asleep. I don't blame him. I'd been asleep.
He's 80 something years old. You know what I mean? Obviously shows why he probably wasn't there physically. And you know what I mean? Yeah. I think they mentioned Alex Lowe too. He wasn't there for the two popes last year. So, or the young pope or some other pope.
Yeah. The two popes, so. Yeah, he's getting too old to travel.
I have some good news for you. Are you an NCIS fan?
No, but I hear there's a luau in our future.
Hey, yep. Not only has NCIS LA been renewed, but the Hawaii spinoff has been ordered. So, a wiki waki wookie, banana nana fooey.
Okay, so how many does that make now? Tell me.
Just three, right? Is it four?
We have NCIS. We have New Orleans, if that's still around.
New Orleans, yeah.
LA, and now Hawaii. We used to have New York. We used to have New York, but
five.
Yeah, but or is that CIS New York? I don't know. There was so many.
Well, it's CSI New York. You're thinking of Gary Sinise? No, that's not it.
That was CSI. Okay.
Unless New Orleans also died. You're all right. I don't know. Scott Bakula. I don't know if that got picked up or not. Obviously, neither one of us are fans. So.
I only see the New Orleans one comes on at 7 o'clock in a syndication every Saturday for some reason. And I sometimes see it. I don't know.
This might be an interesting show. I mean, you might watch though. Lionsgate has confirmed that American Psycho TV show is in the works. So that can be an interesting one here. Let's just watch out. If you ever hanging out with someone that seems a little bit weird and Huey Lewis in the news plays, I might want to leave the room.
Well, I guess you won't be driving in my car anytime soon.
Speaking of good movies being TV shows, HBO's working on a Parasite series, and it will be an original series, not a continuation or it's the same realm as as the last one. So it'll be an original series with original actors. The Thor Love and Thunder cast just got a little bit bigger. Russell Crowe has been added to play Zeus, so that'll be a fun one here. Russell Crowe making his, I believe, his MCU debut, right? So
yeah, absolutely.
Interesting news here. We mentioned before on the show that Aziz Ansari's Master of None Season 3 is returning, except this time Season 3 is going to center around Letha Waite's character, Denise. Ansari is still involved. He will be directing the show. And it does sound like, because she's his friend, that he could also pop up. But now he'll be the side character if he does indeed is in any of the episodes. So that's an interesting take. I don't mind that. That was kind of interesting.
It is.
Your favorite movie, the Snyder Cut of Justice League, helped bring over 3 million new subscribers to HBO Max. Let's see if they stay now.
Yeah, they'll flee. Trust me, they'll flee.
Netflix is in final talks to bring a Kiss biopic shouted out loud to the main screen, or I guess to your television screen, because what I should say. I just hope it's a it's not too much Gene Simmons involved. I want a real tale, because I feel like Gene Simmons will make it to where they look really cool and they're the best. And finally, I put this news last for you, at least my last piece of news. Your boy, Jason Statham, has confirmed they are working on The Meg 2. So, whoop-dee-doo, they'll start filming next year, The Meg 2.
So is Ruby Rose, did she, I think she survived, she could come back, right?
I think she's very dead, if I recall.
Did she die in that one? I'm trying to remember, I don't recall it.
I know either. Dwight from The Office is dead.
Yeah, he died. And also, he died on the whale.
Masioka from Heroes is also very dead.
Yeah, did you talk John Wick? Did any John Wick news?
I have to confirm whether or not I went over John Wick news in the last 2 minutes. No,
no, because I do hear you, but I just wanted to make sure, because I was just looking at something that it has nothing to do with our show. But no, it was the John Wick the series, the Continental, will be coming out. It's going to be an each episode. I believe there's only going to be a few episodes, but they're hour and a half a piece. Crazy. I think there's like five episodes, hour and a half a piece or something like that, or three to five episodes or something like that.
Mini movies, yeah. Or they are movies, yeah. Really, at that point.
Yeah, at that point, you know, but they're going to call it a series. So, that's going to probably be like one of those.
Wasn't Small Axe on Amazon kind of the same thing, where it was like three?
Sherlock did that too.
Yeah, it was usually pretty feature length of them.
Yeah, so I thought that was a pretty different take of how to do a series, an hour and a half a piece, and it's going to be talking about the young, what's his name? Who's the dude who runs the Continental? That dude. It's going to be centered around him.
Ian McShane.
Yeah, Ian McShane's younger character, so that'll be interesting to see. It's kind of like a prequel of some sort. So, but I don't really have much more. You know, that's. Here's a clever note I just heard. Season 3 of The Boys. We all love that show, right? Mm-hmm. They're using over 3 times more fake blood in this show coming up this season. So, woo, we're going to have some bloodiness. A little fun fact there, huh?
It's not like the show already was lacking blood.
No, you know, that opening scene in the first episode, that right there shocked the heck out of you, didn't it?
Do you mean this scene?
Let's see this scene. I love this scene. It's a great scene. So, hold on. Darn ads. What's going on here? Oh, that's not an ad, is it? here it is. God almighty. Yeah, there you go. That one scene right there is what would be in one horror film, I think, you know? But yeah, geez, Louise, liquefied. I love The Boys, and I can't wait for it to come back. I can't wait for the female version, the girls. I don't know if that's what it's called, but Amazon is putting up the female version pretty soon. So I'm excited all in all. But no, man, I congratulations on a successful showies. I thought we did well tonight. You know, it was a great idea, and I think we both executed it. Well, there's a few things we can do better, like probably be in the same room and maybe get Liam Neeson to give one of them away, at least, remember, you know, or Gerard Butler.
Maybe he'll win for The Marksman, or maybe Butler will win for, I don't know, whatever.
Well, whatever movie he comes out with this year. So I can't wait. Gerard's got to come out with one, because Nicolas Cage has already come out with one. So they got to go tit for tat this year.
Tit for tat, starring Nicolas Cage, probably.
Nicolas Cage and Gerard Butler. Oh, what a movie that'll make. One who doesn't talk, the other one does, but in a bad New York accent. You know what? You know, okay, let me tell you this. The reason why you like Greenland better, I figured this out. Because he used his regular accent. He did not try to put on one. He said he was from Scotland. He was just a Scottish brogue, and it worked. And I think that's what he should do, just like Sean Connery. Screw it. He's a Russian. He's a Russian captain, but he has a Scottish brogue. Go with it. You know what I'm saying? So just do that. You know, be Sean Connery. You know, just don't even worry about accents. But I can't wait. So there you go, everybody. a long-winded ending by me. And I can't wait. Kate Winslet has that new show I'm going to watch over there on HBO Max. I hear she puts on a great Philadelphian accent. Never knew somebody had one of those, but can't wait. So there you go, boss. So I thank you. I know you put your robe on. Okay, you put your robe on.
I got chilly.
So I mean, it's time to go to bed. So I thank you again. I loved your showy's idea. I wish I had ideas.
You do. Top 10 monkey movies.
Don't forget next top 10, top 10 shrimp films.
Ace Ventura again will probably be on the list.
Under the Sea. or we'll just have the Under the Sea films. You know.
Or maybe not. Tune in next week to find
out. Your top 10 mermaids.
I never saw Splash.
I can't believe this. I, you know, this is the reason why I'm down to like 17 shows. 17 shows. You get 10 more. You get 10 more John Candy films under your belt, sir, and then I'll stay.
All right, that's all I need. I don't know if there's 10 I haven't seen. I have to look it up.
Oh, there's a lot of them out there, buddy. A lot of them. By the way, I would love to do top 10 John Candy. We haven't done John Candy.
I have to see if I can again.
Okay, well, anyway, we'll talk about this after the show. So, anyway, I thank you guys for watching the show about shows. Like it, subscribe it, and I hope you enjoyed the show, is because if this is a success, it will continue. Yes, it will continue, but with some celebrity support, we hope. Sir, anything you want to say before anything you want to plug before we leave?
Let's see. This will be up by then. Sunday, May 2nd. The Crown Plaza Hotel. It's the Southwest Florida Comic Con, including RPW Wrestling. So we're hosting like 3 hours of wrestling, like 12 plus matches. It's going to be awesome.
How much is that going to cost? What's the admission?
So here's the thing. To the wrestling, it's free. All you got to do is pay to enter the con. So $20, not only do you get to see a three-hour wrestling show if you want, but there will be a cosplay contest. There'll be other seminars and comic book artists. And if you like Funko Pops and toys, there'll be plenty to look at. And also, if you're a wrestling fan, Brutus the Barber Beefcake will be in attendance. I'm trying to convince him to put Dutch in a sleeper hold in the main event. So stay tuned. Yeah,
and he has to cut my hair? Can he cut my hair?
Oh, dude.
I wish I had longer hair, man. I wish I had longer hair because I would let him do whatever the hell he needs to. That'd be so much fun. You know what? Well, if you can do it, we'll do it. I promise. But he'll probably want tons of money. Tons of money. How much is his cameo? We'll just pretend, we'll pay him whatever he does for a cameo.
Well, we'll look it up here. So, yes. Tune in next week where we'll all have footage of Dutch getting his haircut by Brutus the Barber Beefcake, but probably not.
Maybe not. We'll just say. So thank you guys again. Thank you for showing us. And go show some support to a 3-hour wrestling Comic-Con wrestling show up there in Fort Myers.
Dutch McAllister, JPO, as he said, like, subscribe, let a friend know. If you disliked it, let an enemy know. And as usual, hey, we love you more than you'll ever know.
God, why do you lie to these people?
It's fun.